Hello, my name is Mark DiCarlo. Today my guest is Professor of History, Jim Klein. Thank you for coming on.
Sure. Thanks for having me.
Apologies for my being late. Of course, sure. Professor of History, we're living history right now. You followed the presidential election and Mr. Trump won and Hillary Clinton lost. And then there is this issue regarding WikiLeaks, and there's this issue regarding why she won if she outspent him by such a large amount of money. And now the Republicans control the Senate and the Congress and the presidency. So, right. A lot of issues. Why do you think Hillary Clinton lost the election?
Well, I mean, I'm going to parse my words here just a little bit. She hasn't lost yet. She won't until December 19th. That's when the Electoral College meets.
You don't think the fact that she conceded should be considered? Isn't that like throwing in the towel? I lost.
I suppose, but technically the election for the president doesn't take place till December 19th.
I actually read a blog by an attorney who said that technically the concession means nothing and that she could technically win, basically.
I suppose. I don't know. I mean, you know, the electors are not bound to follow the majority vote in state. It's a state-by-state vote, and there have been rebel electors in the past, not recently. I think the most recent example of that was back in the 1940s, 1948 election, when Strom Thurmond ran as a Dixiecrat, and some of the electors in several of the states voted against the majority vote in their state, voted for or against Strom Thurmond, as I recall.
The Electoral College, I thought the protests when Trump won, my personal opinion, I said, well, this is a little ridiculous. He won.
Mm-hmm.
My idea of protest is you want to do something.
Right.
I want to end
right.
the war.
Right.
I
right.
want to change right. Electoral College. I want to, but just to protest. Well, he won. So, what about this Electoral College? You're a professor of history.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think the Electoral College should be changed? I personally think it should be. I think it should be a popular vote, in part because it's happened now twice within approximately 15 years.
That's 16 years. That's right.
Yes, within So I think it should be changed. I personally think that a lot of people don't vote in their state because they say, well, what difference does it make anyway?
Right.
Does it make any difference because Trump is going to carry Texas, so why should I go vote for Hillary Clinton and vice versa? So I think it kind of suppresses the vote. Also, it's my opinion that you could have a lot more fraud in these elections with the Electoral College. All you have to do is look at a couple states that it's close and you have to maybe just defraud maybe 2,000 or 3,000 votes in
sure.
one or two states. So
sure.
I think it breeds fraud. But those are my thoughts. What are the? I don't know. You're a professor of history. I don't really know if that's American history.
Yeah.
Is it? Mm-hmm. What are the purposes of the Electoral College? And is it? Do you think it's being? Is it effective as they always use the word founding fathers intended it to be? And are you in favor of the Electoral College staying?
Yeah. So I mean. For the longest time, they said, the framers, when they first created the Constitution, James Madison and the others said that the reason that they wanted an electoral college is they didn't want to trust the American people with the awesome responsibility of electing a president. They thought the American people were not sufficiently politically savvy.
All right.
They were too easily duped.
Okay.
And in the modern era now, in the 20th, now 21st century, a lot of people said, well, those characteristics really don't apply to the American people anymore. You can make that argument, I suppose. In some ways, I think, this is, I guess, one man's opinion, the Electoral College was designed to prevent someone like Donald Trump from being elected president. And so if the electors elect him, and I think that they will on December 19th, then it begs the question, what is the purpose of the Electoral College? I'm not sure if it has one.
So you're impliedly stating that it has no purpose and that therefore it probably should be gotten rid of because they are in fact going to follow the desires of the voters.
I think so. I mean, it's always, there's been, I think, two electors now come out from Texas, at least one from Texas anyway, and said that one said that he's not going to vote at all, mm-hmm. and one said that he's going to vote for a different candidate.
Right.
I think he said explicitly it would not be Hillary Clinton, but it would be somebody else.
You pose something interesting. I feel that unlike the media, I feel that in many respects, Trump found his own voice. He had a viable platform that spoke to many working people because he identified a problem regarding jobs. And he made a cogent argument on how to get those jobs back by tariffs, taxes, et cetera. So he made a cogent argument. I think that's where his base primarily was in states, mm-hmm. Michigan, Ohio, Pennsylvania, where there's still a lot heavily populated states, with a lot of electoral votes. And those people say, we want our jobs back. So I think he came up with a cogent plan. Having said that, your argument's interesting. I think I don't think he was the bizarro candidate a lot of people are saying he was. Mm-hmm. If he would have been, maybe the Electoral College would have came through and said, hey, well, look, we're not going to allow the head of the Ku Klux Klan or, et cetera. Because there is some dissension minor against him anyway. So that's an interesting take as a last protection. Mm-hmm. Of the American citizenry against a real radical candidate. I was disappointed in many respects regarding the Hillary Clinton campaign. I never thought she had a cogent platform. My opinion was, she said, vote for me because I'm a woman and vote for me because I'm not Trump.
Right.
I didn't see any identification of the homeless problem, which is enormous, which would have been something very fair to talk about, because it not only impacts the homeless, it impacts the citizenry of every city.
Sure.
You know, I didn't hear anything about that. And the jobs issue, that's an issue that's arguable, because really Trump is trying to stop the direction that the country's been going in for many, many years. So I could believe that that's not a, and I believe she believes more in international trade. I don't agree with it, but it's a viable position, right?
Sure.
Because we've been doing it. So I just never saw the platform. I think her record as Secretary of State being pro-war did not appeal to many progressives.
Right.
You know, her record on some of the statements she made about joking about the killing of Gaddafi resonated in many of our citizens' minds.
Right.
So I thought that I didn't get why the left was so, what would you say, nonplussed. Why were they so surprised, but given her platform? How do you see that? Am I correct, do you think? I know you're not really a political science professor, but you're a history professor, but you're very active politically. God bless you. One day I saw you out campaigning against Citizens United. Mm-hmm. I thought very well of you for that. So what are your opinions on those issues?
I think the Clinton campaign has made some mistakes. I mean, that's going to be true, I think, in any election that is, you know, for a losing campaign. I think that while Bernie Sanders was still in the campaign yet in spring, that his presence forced her to talk about some of these issues. And that once he conceded, then she stopped talking about those issues. She moved either to the center, or, as you said, I think especially after the Democratic convention this past summer, from that point on, from Labor Day on, she really made the argument that, you know, I'm not Trump. And you know, that's kind of a negative motivation to get people to vote. And I think their voters were looking for something more than that. You're right.
Well, it's, you know, for many of us, it's disappointing. I made jokes before. I said, we don't need a revolution in America. We need a revolution against the Democratic and Republican parties that seem to have it cornered, not really representing the interests of the average American.
Right.
Though Donald Trump makes a good case for bringing jobs back, which I agree with, and I do think that the international trade issues are questionable. Obviously, in many respects, regarding taxation, inheritance taxes, et cetera, his platform does favor the very, very rich.
Yeah. And the thing with his trade policies, some of which I would agree with as well, I think as well, that you know, NAFTA was not a good idea. It's not been good for the country on balance. The problem I think that I see, and this is, we saw this in the Brexit vote last summer as well, is that anti-trade sentiment is coupled with a strong, staunch anti-immigrant sentiment as well. It seems to me that there's a lot of, from Trump himself and from his surrogates, from his supporters, a lot of people willing to kind of blame immigrants either from Latin America or from the Middle East or somewhere else, outsiders for the problems here in America. And I just don't see that myself.
Well, my position was, and is I don't understand America's position. We have these immigration laws on the books, and then they say, well, we're not enforcing them, or don't seem to want to enforce them. And this is done through various ways. Obviously, there's this issue regarding the sanctuary cities.
Right.
Who knew about those a year or two ago?
Right.
That there were cities that didn't actually, the state, they're not enforcing federal law. How could that be?
Right.
You have this issue regarding, I've had illegals from New York that I was representing loved ones here, and they would go into the federal courthouse like they had no concern about being arrested, that they didn't think that their illegal status wasn't actually an illegal status. They're able to buy properties. They're able to, take out utilities, have loans for cars. And it would seem that if you're going to have illegals, that you should enforce, you know, it would be easy to enforce it in that manner, or bring in more legal immigrants. Why is it that you don't increase the number of legal immigrants if we think we need them, enforce the laws regarding the illegality? So American people are seeing that, and they're saying, well, it's too ridiculous.
Right. Clearly there's somebody who benefits from the current system.
Yes.
Which restricts the numbers of people who can come in legally. Because if you have undocumented immigrants, then, employers are able to take advantage of that. You know, and I would point to the Sam Cain meatpacking plant here in Corpus Christi as a good example of that. They have a large number of undocumented workers out there. They had an inspection here a couple of years ago. I think it was federal officials came through and inspected, and the workers said that they dramatically changed their work policies while the inspectors were there. They told everybody to slow down, pace yourself, and as soon as the inspectors were gone, it was go like hell again.
I don't know if you're aware of this, and this is a complicated thing, but under Bush Jr., there was actually laws passed stating that employers were supposed to be penalized, and perhaps criminal penalties, for hiring and working illegals. But then they came, then they came in and they said something like, well, we can't enforce it because of some sort of violation of privacy or something. So they have these laws on the books that they're not enforcing regarding the penalization of employers for hiring illegals. And one of the things I think that struck voters with Trump also, if you reduce the number of illegals, wages are going to go up. I don't think there's a doubt in anybody's mind that they would go up one way or another. Now, that's going to drive up the cost for all of us. But on the other hand, small business like me, small businessmen, many of these employees that are making very, very low wages can't afford to hire an attorney.
Right.
So there's that angle, too.
Yeah.
You know, that the American working people are somehow being squeezed. So
The argument that the low wages are hurting small businesses, I've heard that for a long time now. I mean, that higher wages would hurt small businesses. I've heard that for a long time. And the counter to that, I think, is that if you raise wages for documented immigrants, undocumented immigrants, for American citizens, if you raise wages, they're going to have more spending money. People who make less than $100,000 a year spend a much larger share of their annual income on consumer items than do people who are making more than $100,000 a year.
Actually, the Department of Labor, and I quoted this on my Facebook page, did a study, and they said it's simply not true that that these higher wages are going to negatively impact the economy through the minimum wage. And I'm one of those moderate people that believe in some government control, and I do believe in minimum wages. And I thought that even Bernie Sanders, who was portrayed as some sort of a radical by certain elements, I mean, I think he wanted to raise the minimum wage to $15 over a period of time.
Right.
So the impact on the economy, I think, would have generally been favorable. So it was an interesting election from that viewpoint. And how do you, from some of those viewpoints, how do you... analyze the fact that Hillary Clinton outspent Trump by a great deal of money and was still able to win the election. Trump was still able to win the election despite that.
Yeah, well, I think you have to look at his earned media, as they call it, in the business, or the fact that he got so much free publicity because he said such outlandish things that the press covered him repeatedly, and so he didn't have to spend. I mean, that's where your biggest expense comes from is television ad buys, especially on the national market, and he didn't have to do very little of that. Certainly in the primary really not throughout the summer and even into the fall yet. He kept saying things that became national news then that night. And so he got free publicity because of that.
But later he was vilified for many of those remarks too. And they would get one remark and they would make a big deal about it, etc.
Yeah, he was. And I think though that he spoke to even some of his racist comments, homophobic comments, his misogynistic comments, spoke to a certain part of the population that at least tolerates, if not agrees with that still.
What did you think, the WikiLeaks had any impact on the election? And by the WikiLeaks, obviously, I mean the release of various Clinton emails and Democratic National Committee emails regarding various things that many of us were very disappointed in hearing.
Right.
Obviously, the discussion that there should be an Arab Spring for Catholics and that Catholics, there are certain organizations, some of this wasn't even published that well, that there, you know, that Catholics need to be freed from the domination of the hierarchy and other major, let's see, what were some of the other major issues? Her referring to the members of the Democratic Party as the Red Army, what we're going to do to plead the Red Army. I'm bringing that up because I think ultimately it did have an effect on a certain number of people.
I think so too. And those were mistakes, I guess, by the Clinton campaign. The leaks themselves, you know, the CIA, I think, has confirmed this now, that those leaks are tied back to Russia and one of the ways in which the Russians influenced the election this past time around.
See, I think that Hillary Clinton, in many respects, when she's made statements that I was proud to be a Goldwater girl, I think that she is one of these Democrats, similar to Obama, perhaps more extreme, that is in many respects, they used to use that rhino phrase. I think in many respects, Hillary Clinton is nothing more than a Republican. I don't think she has a progressive platform regarding the economy, trade.
Yeah.
I don't think she's, that's why she didn't speak to those issues.
I think certainly regarding economic issues, that's perhaps true. I think she has a solid progressive record when it comes to the LGBTQ community and to other social issues
That's not quite true either. She was formally against homosexual marriage, correct? And then she changed her position.
At some point, yeah. Obama was as well. When he came into office, he was opposed
right.
to
marriage. And many of us, are still against it.
He was in favor of same-sex partnerships, but not marriage.
Right, that's right.
And he changed that once he was in office.
Well, I kind of liked Bernie Sanders' phrasing that you have to get away from identity politics.
Yeah.
The Democrats are, in fact, trying to win these elections by identity politics. And I made jokes. I said, okay, now what are they going to add after the LGBT and then they add Q? Right. What are they going to add now? Fetishists? Pedophiles? Where are you going? You know, how far is this? You know, you're going to do this forever? And actually, after the election, I saw some indication that they do want to include some of those groups. So, I don't think that's, I think the Democrats are in philosophical trouble if they continue along that line and they don't endorse more of the platforms of people like Bernie Sanders, I think, who was, I thought him a good candidate until he sold us out. You know, there was that issue that he, not necessarily that he even had to fight all the way to the floor of the convention, but perhaps his enthusiastic endorsement shouldn't have been there. Did you have an opinion on that?
No, I mean, I think, well, I have an opinion, actually. I guess I think that I agree with Bernie Sanders' approach. I liked him as a candidate, supported him in the primary in the spring, but when it became apparent that the Clinton campaign had wrapped up the primary, had garnered that, then I thought that he was correct to concede. And I think, especially given the alternative, Donald Trump, as the likely nominee for the Republican Party, that he was correct in endorsing Hillary Clinton as well and emphasizing, look, I have differences with Hillary Clinton, but she and I agree on so much more than what Donald Trump and I agree upon. And she would be so much better for the country than what would be Donald Trump.
I don't know, but I've read various things, and, mm-hmm. and I read that there were a number of Sanders supporters that did support Trump, and that they said it was a low percentage. I could tell you that I was a Sanders supporter that did vote for Trump for whatever reason that opinion is. So I wonder how many. I think there's a fair number of those people.
Yeah, there's a. I don't know how many exactly, but you're right. I'm not on Facebook very much myself. My wife is on Facebook quite a bit, and she said that she saw a lot of comments from Sanders supporters who, you know, announced anyway that they're going to be voting for Trump rather than for Clinton.
And obviously who I voted for, that's just another opinion. Mm-hmm. It's not really that relevant, but I would tell you this, in the presidency, that's the first time I ever voted a Republican. And I tell you another thing is I don't think that enough people gave Trump credit for what I was telling you, coming up with an original platform that wasn't necessarily in line with the same Republican Party line. Deregulation, cut taxes for the rich, you know, the same statements that I've been hearing ever since Ronald Reagan, which I do not believe were effective in any manner.
Right.
He stated that he identified a problem. He said, look, we got crumbling cities, we got crumbling airports, we got to solve that. We want to bring jobs to America. So I've got to say that the platform, one could argue that I think he beat her on the platform.
Yeah, maybe so. I mean, it's interesting now in the transition that the planks of his campaign platform seem to be getting abandoned now.
Well, I don't doubt that. Yeah. I don't have that. Look, I don't have that much faith in the guy. I voted for President Obama twice, and I don't think he did such a bang up job. I mean, I think Obamacare is not good.
Right.
I think Obamacare was a great disappointment. And
I think, though, that Obamacare is still better than what we had before. I mean, I'm sitting here as a person who has a pre-existing condition. I think it's better than what we had before.
It's been very good for the people with pre-existing conditions. But for people like me that have to go out and buy these policies, and everyone that I know, the deductibles went up, the premiums went up for the entire middle class.
And that's not caused by Obamacare. They were going up before that.
They have been going up.
Before that, they were rising, escalating sharply for 20 years before that already.
I believe, I don't know this statistically, that the escalation went up more markedly under Obamacare. But again, some of this is anecdotal.
A lot of it's disappointment, I think, that people thought that it was going to do more than what it did. We were sold that as well, that, you know, obviously it did allow people to keep their insurance, even if they had a pre-existing condition. We were also told, though, that it was either going to reduce or at least slow the growth in prices and costs, and that we haven't seen.
Well, you said we were sold that, and that's something that I've been saying ever since they've come out and they've talked about fake news. I've said, well, who's President Obama? When he came up and told us this about Obamacare and it's reported by the media, that's fake news. To me, when you come out and you start a war in Afghanistan or you start a war in Iraq on fraudulent pretenses, that's fake news.
Right.
So this issue regarding fake news is multidimensional. They're trying to pin it on these certain fraudulent internet pages, et cetera, that are fraudulent, and they put out, you know, fake news. But I think fake news is much more multidimensional, you know, than that. Again, when President Obama comes out and says, okay, this is going to do this, it doesn't do it, it's repeated by the media. And when President Obama comes out and says, well, there haven't been any terrorist acts on American soil since I've been president, I think that's fake news and it's reported. Why the emphasis on several issues? Why the emphasis on fake news now? Do you agree that there is a fake news problem? Obviously, historically, we probably have had a fake news problem. Some people believe some of the incidents regarding World War II, et cetera, the reason for Pearl Harbor, et cetera, were fake news. As a historian, where do you see fake news in America? Where do you see it in other countries? Is it a problem in the United States? A lot of issues.
Yeah, so I mean, it all comes down to, I think, kind of the level of information. We are in a new information era now with the internet and cell phones access and that sort of thing. I think that fake news has gotten worse in the last at least maybe 10 years or so now, maybe in just the last couple of years. And I would disagree. I think I distinguish between comments made by candidate Obama or President Obama about the Affordable Care Act and then how it exactly worked. Because you could make the argument that, well, you couldn't have known exactly what the exact consequences are going to be. Perhaps he misled us on some aspects, but I think that these fake news websites are something entirely different, attributing, you know, things that just simply never happened. I mean, on one of these websites, for instance, and this is how you would know that it's a fake news website, There are articles in there about politics here in America, about candidates, candidate A or candidate B. And at the bottom of the page, there's a story about a 385-year-old woman in China. Well, I mean, come on. If you look to the bottom of the page, you know what you're looking at then, but a lot of people don't do that.
For whatever reason, I've myself have seen a number of postings on Facebook that look to be fake, and then I would research it, and I would notify these people. I said, look, I don't, you know, you should really research these items before you put them on there. One of the advantages, though, of this direct access, there's advantages, though, too, to like Trump was able to bypass the media through Twitter, et cetera, and go directly to the people. So there's not such a monopoly on the news by the mass media. And so it has some, even though there is fake news, there's also a filter. The news that the candidate wants to get out could be less filtered as well. So there's some good points, correct? Oh, yeah.
Sure, sure. I mean, that's the benefit of the internet, is that you're not going to have as much control over the information that's coming out there. The problem, or the downside, is that it's as much information as you've got out there, you got, I think, probably twice or almost three times as much misinformation out there, because you can say anything on the net. I mean, I just love this quote. Mm-hmm. I use this every semester in my classes. Quote from Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah, I see that. Yeah. It's obviously fraudulent.
You can't always believe what you see on the internet.
Right.
That's Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah. Well, that's pretty funny. That's pretty funny. Well, this Mark Zuckerberg, who they assert, I think it's fake, but they assert that he founded Facebook and he did it on his own. The storyline, I think, is probably fake. But whatever. Mm-hmm. Mark Zuckerberg says that they're going to try to do something on Facebook about fake news.
Well, if they can, that'll be helpful. I don't know how you can, really, because the nature of the net is you can say anything there.
Well, you know, The Onion, I've seen it's a sarcastic...
Satire paper.
I've seen a number of people post things from The Onion on the internet that said it thought it was real.
Right. The Chinese government was taken in by The Onion about... This is 20 years ago already, I think, mid-90s. And the article was... satirical article was that the nation's capital is moving out of Washington, D.C., out of the District of Columbia, because the District of Columbia refused to build a new capital. You know, likening it to a sports team.
Well,
and Xinhua News picked that up and thought it was real for about, I don't know, 48 hours or 36 hours or something like that.
Well, it's amazing, and you could... tell me, as a professor, if this is true, the attention deficit that is caused by the internet, wherein people post an article, but nobody ever reads the article.
Right.
Well, I like that it's talking about I like the fact that it's talking about Hillary attacking the Catholic Church. I like that article. But then they'll never go to the article to read the context of what happened, what WikiLeaks said about what it was.
Right, and quite often the headlines don't match the article. Right.
Or the article is very poorly written, doesn't make much sense, you know? And obviously some of these writers are pretty good at this. I'm an attorney, I could read pretty closely and I could see, well, this is logically inconsistent, this article. So how about, you've been teaching, I'm assuming, for 20 years?
About 25 years.
25 years. Yeah. And do you think the internet has had a positive or negative effect on people's educational status in America? Are they better educated? Are they educated more poorly now as a result? Is it harder to maintain the attention to read a book now than it was before? Is it it's probably easier to research? Have you noticed any change in the students that you think might be an effect of the internet?
Yeah, so I tell my students this every semester as well. One of the purposes that we, at the history program at Del Mar College, see in a history course is to get people to read and think critically. Critical thinking is one of these big buzzwords in education now, higher education and K-12, I guess.
You say that with some sarcasm.
Well, because a lot of buzzwords.
It's trending, you're right.
Yeah. Right. Okay. But I mean, the idea to look at something and don't just take it at face value.
Right.
That's especially valuable now in the internet age because, as I said, you can read anything out there. You know, if I were to pull up, if I were to do a Google search of the Jewish Holocaust, I'm sure it would not take me very many hits to find a website that says the Jewish Holocaust was a myth. Never happened.
Well, you see that. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So if I'm coming to a topic for the first time, coming cold to a topic, let's say I want to find out about, I don't know, the average rainfall in Brazil, and I know nothing about it. So I go to the first website, and the first website says the average rainfall in Brazil is, I don't know, 10 inches a year. I would think, oh, that seems like awful low, but all right. Who knew? You know, and that's the problem we have right now. So the students especially, and all of us, I think we need to think about things, view things much more critically than we do. Don't just simply accept them at face value. I think you're right. I think that there has been a shortening of the attention span. I see this in myself as well. You know,
I do too.
I read, I'm a historian, so I read a lot of books. I'm willing to plow through a 1,500-page book. Not right away. You know, it's going to take me time to get through it. But when I get to an article on the net, on a website, if it's more than two or three screens long, I start flipping to the bottom thinking, how long is this stupid thing? So I see to myself, I'm just not willing to kind of stick with it. I'm willing to put the time in to read it. If it's as I said, in print form, in paper copy. But on the net, I find myself much more impatient about that. And I think that I see the same thing in my students too.
Well, it's interesting though, you're still able to sustain an interest and the ability to get through a 1,500-page book or 1,000-page book,
right?
Which is more than some of us are able to do. Yeah. I don't know.
But I mean, again, that's not going to happen suddenly. That might happen over the course of several weeks or
so. So what's the last book you read?
Actually, right now, I am reading in the midst of a book. It's about the history of the AAUP. It's the Faculty Association, American Association of University Professors, formed 101 years ago.
That's got to be like the most boring book. Yeah. Only a professor in a... No, just teasing.
Actually, I'm an
officer. I'm hard teasing you.
No, I'm an officer in the AAUP. That's part of the reason I had interest in it as well. And you're right. It is pretty dry, very detailed. But then they talked about World War I. And and so the AAUP formed to defend defend what they call academic freedom, the ability to kind of control what's going on in the classroom, classroom instructor. And then by the time we get to World War I, or just 2 years after the organization is founded, all sorts of professors are being dismissed for pro-German sentiments or supposedly anti-American sentiments. And the AAP was kind of powerless to do anything about that.
Well, we were at war with Germany, so you can almost see it.
Right? You know, if you're going to have free speech, then you got to have free speech.
Well, do we have free speech on campuses now?
No, we don't, actually. I mean, it's not a dumb R. We have a
and
free speech
zone. It's from the left. It's from the left, too, isn't it? The left is very, very very pro-censorship in certain issues, aren't they?
I don't know about that. I think they're more willing to have these kind of open discussions.
Well, are you allowed to say, let's say that I got on campus and I want to do a speech on why I'm against homosexual marriage, why I think that homosexuality is a sin. Mm-hmm. Would I be able to do that, or would I get protested like crazy?
I think you'd get protested.
Right. Well, you think
right? But that's not the same as saying you can't do it.
Okay, so there's like... There's how many years of civilized human history up until the last 10 years we had this position. Now, if I go on there, I'm some great radical if I say that. Right?
Yeah, I suppose. But that doesn't mean you can't say it. So
I don't know if you can.
You would have free speech to say that. And
what if you were a professor? Could a professor say it and lose his job?
Yeah, I think they could say that in class. I mean, I would argue. I would take the position that they should have the position to be able to, you know, the right to be able to do that. There was.
I thought that was considered a form of bigotry or racism, and that you could lose your job for that. Maybe not. Maybe you do have free discussion on campus, etc.
Well, I mean, the purpose again in the classroom in particular. I think in the classroom, the purpose is to try to kind of further knowledge, increase knowledge, and so you can do that by having the broadest possible discussion, and sometimes that's going to involve positions or opinions that are rather unpopular. And we need to have those conversations to be able to kind of resolve that, and hopefully in what they call the marketplace of ideas, that the best ideas will rise to the top.
According to what I read, and it might be from the right-wing press, again, you can't tell what's real, but they would have you believe that in a position as a professor, there's many ideas that you're not allowed to state, or you risk getting the... tenure and all that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you really don't believe that's the case?
I don't think so. I mean,
I don't know.
John Yoo was one of the architects of the George W. Bush administration's policy on enhanced interrogation or torture.
Mm-hmm.
And later on went out to, I think it was Stanford University, I believe it's Stanford, maybe Berkeley. And came under fire from students because he was basically asserting, he's making this legal argument in defense of enhanced interrogation or torture.
Well, that's pretty bad.
And the AAP defended him. And I would say that he has the right to say that.
Well,
he's making a legal argument, you know.
But there, go ahead, I'm sorry.
He's making a legal argument in class trying to demonstrate how legally they decided to do this. I think that's a part of the conversation that should be had in the classroom.
I think that was, again, using my fake news, I think that was fake news from the Bush administration regarding any legality or legal excuses for torture. And you can go back to the Nuremberg trials, et cetera, the definitions, and historically, that is torture. And they can give it new names, and they can call it enhanced interrogation techniques. But I don't know that to me, that's almost like saying on campus, murder should be legal. No, that's something you can't be saying. I do believe, you know, you're not allowed to say a murder or I'm for the genocide of a certain group. I don't believe in that. So,
And to be fair, I mean, to be clear, I'm not in favor of those policies myself.
Right.
I'm not in favor of torture or enhanced interrogation. It was torture. It was torture. It was clearly torture. And I'm opposed to it. You know, there are a certain moral issue here as well, moral argument to be made. But beyond that, there's a very practical matter as well that the military has made regarding this as well, that if we employ those tactics ourselves, we should expect anybody who's fighting against us to use the same tactics as well.
And Senator John McCain, former presidential candidate, he made that argument too. Let me say something else, because I know a little bit about that subject. I know a lot about it. They don't need to torture.
Right.
That's a fraud. The CIA knows that.
Right.
You control the environment, the social milieu, the cultural milieu, you can get somebody to talk in a matter of days with no need for torture whatsoever.
Well, and not just that, but if you know, again, the studies indicate that use of torture will get you bad information every time. Because whoever's being tortured will tell you whatever they think you want to hear just to get the torture to stop.
There's discussion about that. I think there's a degree of truth in that, but I do think that generally speaking, there are indications that people will pretty much say everything they know when being tortured also. So what do you teach this semester? What are you teaching right now?
I'm just finishing up now. We started exams on Thursday. I'm scheduled to give more exams on Monday at the end of the semester. On Monday, the class that I'm giving the exams in is the History 1301 course that we just finished up with the Civil War.
Okay, that's an interesting subject.
Yeah.
So, is the Civil War, is people's popular conception that the Civil War was about slavery, is that true or is that not true?
It depends on who you ask.
Asking you. You're the professor.
Right. So, if you talk to academics, and I would include myself in this as well, if you talk to academics for the last 45 years now, it's been a consensus agreement, again, a few outliers, but the consensus agreement amongst most historians is slavery was the central issue that brought us to the Civil War. It's only outside of academia, political officials, elected officials, others, political commentators who have been continuing to make this argument that slavery was really a side issue or ancillary issue or really was not involved at all. That was really settled 45 years ago by historians.
Well, central issue, that's kind of a nebulous statement. We were taught that it was the central issue was to save the Union.
So you're right. And I tell my students this as well. If you had interviewed somebody to interview the Union soldiers marching off to war in April of 1861, and asked them how many of you are going to end slavery, almost none of them would have said yes. You'd ask the Confederate soldiers at the same time, April of 1861, how many are you going to war to preserve slavery? Almost none would say yes. Union soldiers would have said we're fighting to preserve the Union. The Confederate soldiers would have said we're fighting to preserve our freedoms or our independence. Mm-hmm. But slavery is still the issue. It's the defining issue. It's slavery tells you whether you're in the South or in the North.
Why historically did was America maybe the only Western country that needed a civil war that had a civil war to end slavery? Is that a correct statement? And what's the historical basis for?
Yeah, I guess so. I don't think there's any others that I can think of, no.
Right. Okay, well, this might not be an issue. Yeah. It, you know, I thought it was, I thought an interesting issue, and you know, and it has come up before. So, that American history course is primarily related to the Civil War period.
It runs from the age of Columbus all the way up to the Civil War, from the discovery of the Americas, the exploration of the Americas by the Europeans in about 1492.
What about the another discussion? Mm-hmm. You know, obviously we know that in many respects, when we, you know, whatever we said, Columbus discovered America, right? We're told this. Well, his name really wasn't Columbus, and he didn't discover America.
Right.
He discovered the Americas for Western Europe.
Right.
Is that right?
That's right. And he wasn't even the first doing that. I mean, Leif Erikson and the Vikings had been here several hundred years earlier. But what Columbus does do is he initiates what the historians refer to as the Columbian Exchange, back and forth across the ocean after him. You know, the Europeans are coming here now, they're bringing Native Americans back over to Europe once again as well. There's a great deal more trade now that begins to steadily build now after 1492, and you didn't see that after the Vikings came here. They had kind of a one-time settlement that seemed to kind of expire, and then really nothing else came after that, until Columbus.
And was there mass slaughter of Indians...
Yeah.
By people coming from wherever, Europe, England, etc., or did most native peoples die from whatever virus, smallpox, mm-hmm. etc., and it wasn't really a genocide? Was it genocide or wasn't it genocide? Can you answer that question?
It depends on how you define a genocide. So did most of the Native Americans who were killed, who died, did most of them die because of disease? Yes. Was that intentional? From what we can tell, for the most part, it was not intentional. We have a couple of examples of intentional disease being spread to the Native Americans.
I've read three or four such examples.
Yeah, but
suppose even in Texas, correct?
This one is in, I want to say this is in New York, colonial mm-hmm. New York, about the 1750s. Our British officer mm-hmm. sent blankets that he knew were... smallpox-infected blankets meant to send them to the local Native American population to devastate them, and it was very effective. But as I said, that's the only example we know. One of the challenges of studying colonial history in particular is that our sources are really sporadic, and so that doesn't necessarily mean that's the only time it ever happened. It's the only time that we have this documented. And we historians, we have to kind of rely on our documents. And so it may have happened at other times as well. We just don't have good knowledge about that.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I may have been distracted for a second. So basically, you're stating that that the mass extinction of the indigenous people in at least whatever the United States of America, and of course the whole continent is pretty big, but in the United States of America was primarily due to diseases. It wasn't due to.
That's correct. Now, once the Europeans arrive, first of all, there are some Native Americans who are killed in fights, wars with the Europeans. There are some examples of Native Americans being enslaved by the Europeans and being literally worked to death as well. It's hard to kind of parse, pull the two apart, because you look at the Taino Indians out in the Caribbean, one of the first groups that Columbus and the others encountered, within 50 years that population is virtually extinct. And why is that? Well, it's because they suffered from smallpox and measles and other European disease-based diseases. But it's also because they're being worked 12, 13, 14, 15 hours in a day. And so if you're being worked 15 hours a day, you're much more susceptible to disease then as well. And so there's really kind of a combination of those things that are taking place.
There's historical evidence that there was some mass slaughters in various villages, et cetera, maybe up to 150 or so. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, there are different attacks, wars between the Europeans, European Americans, and the Native Americans, and those were, for the most part, no-holds-barred wars. And so the Europeans, if they gained the upper hand, slaughtered large numbers of Native Americans. Native Americans tried to do the same thing to the European Americans as much as they could as well. Simply didn't have the weaponry.
Have you followed this since we're discussing that? I didn't mean to interrupt you since we're discussing
sure.
that. I haven't really had an opportunity to follow the pipeline issue very closely.
Yeah.
And I haven't been able to come to a conclusion. What is the status of the, was that in South Dakota? Was that in
Standing Rock, Sioux Indian Reservation up in North Dakota.
North Dakota. Did you see that as, from what you were able to determine, did you see that as a genuine violation of whatever their treaties were and or their their reservations in the period?
Very much so. You and I have talked about this before. I've been involved in a number of different environmental issues here in the area as well. And so I still have environmental concerns about the Dakota Access Pipeline. They're apparently now planning to go around to bypass the reservation. But independent of the environmental issues, this is clearly a land use and really property rights issue. You can't just do that. If the tribe says you can't bring the pipe through our lands, then you simply can't. And to imply that, to try to kind of push it through, which was the case up here until, about a week or so ago, it really harkens back to the 1870s when the Sioux Indians had been promised the Black Hills in the western half of South Dakota and had it taken away from them again in violation of the treaty that the U.S. itself signed.
And one of the I think the problems with the Democratic Party do institute under President Obama, and many people were very, very disappointed that he didn't come out in favor of the Indians and their protests against the pipeline.
I would have liked to have seen his call for you. He leaned on the Army Corps of Engineers, U.S. Corps of Engineers, to not go through the reservation. I would like to have seen him make a statement like that, a month, 2 months earlier, while the campaign is still going on yet. So I think that was a huge source of disappointment. Jill Stein, the presidential candidate for the Green Party, went up there to the area, Standing Rock area, and everyone called it a political stunt. I suppose it was, but I was really sorely disappointed that Hillary Clinton didn't go up there, didn't really say anything about this either. And for that matter, Bernie Sanders didn't either, that I recall. I may have missed something about him, statement by him on that.
Well, what do you think? We were talking at the beginning of the show about the Electoral College and whether or not the efficacy of the Electoral College and whether or not everybody was going to basically all the members of the Electoral College were going to vote as they were supposed to vote and their freedom to do so. And Jill Stein, do you think Jill Stein's count, desire for recounts in three major states, do you think it had a good motivation? Or was she acting as a shell for Hillary Clinton? What's your opinion on the Jill Stein request for the recount?
I don't know about the motivation behind it. I think it's a good idea to have the recount. I think there should be a recount for every election, for that matter. And because you want to be sure, you want to have some confidence in your electoral process. And I think a lot of the people in the United States right now don't have much confidence in that. Interestingly, in Nueces County, if we wanted to have a recount, we could not. Why? There's no paper trail.
Right.
In the states where they're talking about a recount, they have a paper trail behind the machines so you can actually go through and count ballots once again as well to determine the exact number of votes that each candidate got. I think that's only right and fair. The voting machines we're utilizing here now in Nueces County, this is not even true statewide in Texas, but in Nueces County have no paper trail. And so if we wanted to have a recount, we couldn't.
Well, when Trump said that I may not honor the results of the election, he was vilified.
Mm-hmm.
And I posted on Facebook, why is he vilified for saying that? We've had a history of election fraud in the United States in different forms. And obviously, I think it's been ascertained in Kennedy versus Nixon. Mm-hmm. Supposedly, I think it was West Virginia and Chicago area. The Bush-Gore election was very, very questionable.
Right.
So that's two within my lifetime that I know offhand about, and he was vilified. And I said, well, Hillary Clinton should be stating the same thing. If it's questionable, the patriotic thing to do is not to accept it.
Mm-hmm.
The patriotic thing is to say, well, look, I want to, I'm going to wait until I concede. I'm going to wait till every vote is counted. I don't believe in these concessions.
Right.
Wait till every vote is counted. If anything's questionable, I think it's a patriotic thing to demand recounts. If in fact for the electorate,
right?
They keep saying vote. Well, you tell us to vote. You're not counting the votes. There's voter fraud. We have all these we have all these alphabet agencies, CIA, FBI, all these intelligence agencies, and you're not making sure our votes are counted?
Yeah. Now, I want to be clear about this, that when we think about voter fraud, I mean, the example of someone voting, let's say, illegally, voting twice, or voting does not...
Well, that's an issue, too. That's a different issue.
But a very, very rare issue. I mean, I think there's 8 instances of that in the last 16 years. For a nation this size, the number of people who vote at 8 is astonishing. That's a non-issue. The voter ID laws that are supposed to design to reduce that sort of voter fraud are a solution without really a problem.
Well, I didn't want to get into the great specifics about about what happened in Texas and sure. the voter IDs and all that. I personally was more I thought that was a bogus issue. You know, I can't get a voter ID. I don't have a driver's license and I can't get a picture ID and I'm being discriminated. I thought that was a bogus issue on the left, but so
I thought that was a legitimate issue.
Did you?
I
didn't.
Yet. I think that again, for people who don't have a driver's license, they can get a state issued ID. They can get a state issued ID for free, but you have to bring certain documents in to do that. And one of those is a birth certificate. How do you get a birth certificate? Well, you have to pay for that. Isn't that doesn't that constitute a poll tax?
Well, you get ridiculous though. How much is a birth certificate? How many people don't have a birth certificate and can't afford one? What's the infinitesimal amount?
You were talking about the homeless population earlier. I think that if you went to one of the shelters, I think you'd find a large part of the population that has no birth certificate
and
no driver's license.
That's true. And we got more of them every day. Yeah. We got whole cities of them in LA and et cetera.
And those people are eligible to vote, should be eligible to vote as well.
Well, what about historically? Wasn't it discussed that only landowners should be able to vote?
Right. Right.
Wasn't that historically?
Yeah. Yeah. So you're right. When I hear talk about kind of the...
So I should get so many votes because I own more than one property. Just joking. No.
Right. That was actually
idea. Was that discussed?
Not by the 1770s anymore, but when the Carolinas were first founded in the 1660s, those who owned more land had that much more political influence. It wasn't just that you had to own land, but if you owned more land, you had more influence. Bring it full circle, I think that Citizens United has brought that back to us again now.
And the Citizens United decision is basically the Supreme Court decision that stated that corporations are people. People are entitled to free speech. People are entitled to unlimited free speech. Corporations are people. Therefore, they should be entitled to unlimited free speech, and unlimited free speech and free speech constitutes advertising money. Therefore, corporations are entitled to unlimited advertising for political sponsorships, right?
That's right.
Now, I mentioned to you before the show a Supreme Court decision that I tried to make people aware of slightly, but it's been pretty much censored by the media.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I think it's all fake news. So. Mm-hmm. When they don't report a story, I think it's kind of fake news when they're emphasizing something else. And I don't remember the name of the decision, but it basically said the United States Supreme Court said, no, the governor, I believe it was of Virginia, was not guilty of, was it fraud or corruption or bribery for accepting a Rolex watch, I believe it was, and a trip. He was not guilty of that because ingratiation and access to politicians is part of the American, something like it's part of the American process. Therefore, opening the gate.
Right.
To pretty much full bribery to local politicians. I don't even know if they stated where the line is.
Right.
You know, is it a Rolex? I don't know what this Rolex, specifically a Rolex watch. I don't know what a Rolex watch even goes for, having a trust as Casio watch. And you're a history professor and weren't even aware of that. And I know you're concerned about Citizen United because, you know, bless you, I saw you out protesting. I saw you out handing out pamphlets one day in the cold.
Yeah, hey, Citizen United. And I would argue that just as damning, actually, is a much older, relatively older case, Buckley versus Vallejo from 1976. That's the case in which the U.S. Supreme Court first said money equals speech. And that's really where we went wrong.
Yeah. There was a series.
Right.
There was a series of money equals speech, corporations are citizens, unlimited, you know.
Citizens United spawned the super PACs. They didn't exist before Citizens United. And Buckley Vallejo spawned, for the most part, spawned PACs. PACs had been around since the 1940s, I think, but had been very rare, very few in number, and the numbers simply exploded after 1976. You saw them in the 1980s in particular.
And within our lifetimes too, I believe it said that the donors, is it the donors of the PACs are anonymous? Isn't that right?
Yes.
Yes, for that was another one of those Supreme Court decisions.
That's right, right.
I mean, so basically you could have any number of people controlling things behind the scenes, right? Right.
And again, this is a big concern about this as well, that money could be coming from American citizens or it could be coming from somewhere outside the country. We know, in fact, we have a documented example, I think, in San Diego, the mayor's race there, of a donor from Mexico contributed a great deal of money to one of the candidates. That came out after the election was completed. And so we know that there are people outside the United States influencing elections in the United States.
There was a corruption scandal in the Clinton administration. I don't remember all the ins and outs of it. Basically, some Chinese gangster or businessman had donated a bunch of money to the Clinton.
Call that.
Remember that? Mm-hmm. And nobody said a word. Mm-hmm. The Republicans let it go. You know, Democrats didn't say much. That was a true scandal in my view.
Yeah.
That wasn't like the Monica Lewinsky
right.
sexual anecdote story. This was a true scandal that really wasn't picked up by the media.
Yeah, if all that happened, if that was in fact true, in fact, that was correct, you're right. That was a scandal that really should have been investigated much more thoroughly. And not just by the press, but really by the authorities.
We're reaching the end of our show. This has been Jim Klein, professor, and you still call yourself, are you an activist or not?
I try to think of myself as an activist. You know, I'm getting up there in age, I guess, but I try to stay as active as I can.
And Professor Del Mar for over 25 years. And
I've been at Del Mar for 10 years. I've been teaching history for 25, but just at Del Mar for 10 now.
You know, and I'll close on this, but there's been some controversy. I don't know if you want to get into it. Some controversy about a Del Mar campus on the south side and whether or not it should be built, et cetera.
Sure. I think that issue has been decided. The voters voted in favor of it this last election. I opposed it. I think it was a bad idea. I still think it's a bad idea.
Have you noticed on the local elections, they have a pretty effective ways of putting things on the ballot during certain years and giving it a certain degree of publicity, and then so they can manipulate the votes to a certain extent, I think,
maybe.
On a lot of these local issues.
Maybe so. You know, the people in Corpus Christi, I have to say this, have been very generous toward Del Mar College. We asked for bond issues, I think, either 2 or 4 years ago to reconstruction buildings on the East Campus and on the West Campus of the college. And the voters were very generous in supporting that. This time around, people were very generous again. I just didn't see a need. I kept asking myself, if this bond doesn't pass, if we don't build this South Side campus, will I still be able to do my job? The answer is yes. And so I can't see how it's necessary then.
And the student debt issue, the student debt issue is a big issue under Bernie Sanders and Jill Stein. They were talking about forgiving student debts. What does it cost for a full-time student at Del Mar first year? Do you know?
I think it's $100 a credit hour, as I recall. I think $100 for...
And how many credit hours are you supposed to take?
Full-time, 12 hours.
So it'd be $1,200?
I think that's right. I think it's actually $100 for a three-credit hour course. And so I believe that's right, $400 for full tuition.
$400 for full tuition?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, that doesn't seem too onerous, like I've heard.
No, it doesn't. But again, you know, Del Mar College is an open-access institution. We accept everybody. And that means people of all sorts of means. And for some people, $400 is a lot of money.
Thank you, Professor Klein.
Sure. Thanks for
your
time.
As always, sure. Thank you for coming on. Good night.